My God. For anyone just hopping on, Michelle, is that a way to just open up and prepare for you to just minister? Let's see how much I love you. We made sure we brought somebody in that would just make ministry not only easy, but just would flow with whatever God has given to you. For those of you that perhaps are, and I can't even imagine if you live on planet Earth, if you're hearing about Dr. Michelle McKinney Hammond for the first time, best-selling author, so many, and your passion, Michelle, I love the fact that we shared this together, that your passion for motherhood, your passion for raising up this emerging generation. And I just believe, I really believe that this is not just the end, that we're coming together with mothers around the world, but I got this down in the pit of my belly that something is going to be birthed today, that we're going to be collaborating together and continuing on. I don't know if you sense that. And I believe that there's somebody today that has had a challenge with forgiving their mother or just some of the different struggles that Miracle just talked about. I never thought about mothers that have had to battle with addiction. But we do have one with mothers in crisis, but you have something that has come from your alabaster box that's going to be a blessing to us today. We are so ready to receive. And before we do, my love to you. My love to you, sis.
Thank you. Love you. My twin sister.
Yeah. Raise your hands now.
Praise God. You know, I was raised in a community of mothers. So for me, motherhood is not just about birthing babies from our bodies, but it is literally the spirit of motherhood that causes us all to be raised up in the way that God wants us to be raised up. And I tell you, I'm thankful for the village that raised me. My mother was a student in London when I was born, and she did not marry my dad because she was afraid to go to Africa. So she sent me to Barbados to live with my aunts, her sisters. And after they left and went to America, I lived with my grandmother. So I've had many mothers in my life, and I believe that that is why my heart is such a mother's heart, because I was mothered by so many different women that all poured into my life, and I feel that I am a combination of all of them. One that was particularly influential in my life, she was such a generous woman, Pat. And I would watch her. We would go to Barbados, where my mother was from, in the summer after I moved to America when my mom remarried an American. We would go to Barbados. I don't know why I'm sharing this story. That's not part of my message, but we would go to Barbados and I would watch her shop. We would literally go shopping in New York, and she would fill about 4 suitcases full. And none of the stuff would be for her. It would all be for other people. As we shopped, she would say, oh, I think Janet would really like this hat. And oh, so-and-so would really like these shoes. And so that just birthed something in me about being generous and having a spirit and a heart that was always longing to give. It's very hard for me to receive. I enjoy giving. And I really believe I got that from my Aunt Ernie. And as I think about the different parts of who I am, it's interesting. I started writing a book many years ago, The Secret to Anonymous Fame. And I started the book off saying, I'm really not myself. I'm a combination of all the lives that were poured into me. So I hope that that is an encouragement for women who are still believing God for a child and laboring with the burden of really wanting to birth a baby from their bodies. But I just want to share a little bit from the Word of God. You know, it starts in the beginning, acknowledging motherhood right away. In the book of Genesis, it says that Adam called his wife Eve because she was the mother of all living. That's our great, 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 great grandmother. Every person on the face of the earth is related because our mother, Eve, was the one who birthed us all. She carried us all in her loins. And generation after generation, we've been downloaded into the earth realm. And the charge in the garden was to be fruitful, multiply, have dominion, and subdue evil. And I believe that's why in our DNA, is the desire to birth, because it was part of the original command of God that we would be fruitful, that we would bear fruit into the earth, that we would fill the earth with people who knew God. That way we would have dominion because there's power in numbers, and we would subdue evil because we were carriers of the Spirit of God, thereby expanding the kingdom of God. God said, come, let us make man in our image. And we know within man was woman. So he was talking about man and woman. And he desired from the very beginning that we look like him. That is so phenomenal that he wanted us to have his imprint in our spirit, on our countenance, in our actions, through our words. That is so powerful. I just want to ask you today, do you look like your daddy, your Abba Father God? So he created man in his own image, in the image of God. He created them, it said, male and female. And he blessed them. And he said, be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth, subdue it, have dominion over everything that moves on the face of the earth, not just naturally, but spiritually. When we look at 2 Peter chapter 1, it says that he's given us everything we need pertaining to life and godliness. That's talking about life in the natural as well as the spiritual, that he has equipped us to master our lives spiritually as well as naturally. And so when he talks about being fruitful and multiplying, he's not talking about just having babies. He's talking about being productive. He's talking about replenishing whatever we see a need for before us. Multiplying the kingdom of God through our good works. We're creating a hunger and a thirst for people to have a relationship with God because they see God in us. We are enlarging the sphere and influence of the kingdom of God when we look like our Abba Father God. Let your kingdom come. Remember, that was part of the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, that we would always be submitted to God's will, that his will would be performed in the earth. So we're supposed to subdue evil and have dominion by subduing the kingdom of darkness, by being the voice of conviction through our lives. And you know, there's a saying, Pat, that I just love. It says, share Christ as often as you can and only use words when necessary. Hallelujah. So literally, we are, as living epistles, are sharing the message of Christ through our actions, through our words, through our responses to people every day. That is so exciting that we get to look like God every single day. So you're saying, well, what does that have to do with mothers? If we're glorifying God, we're replicating his presence and power in the earth. That's what glorifying God actually means, that we're literally displaying his presence and power through our availability in the earth. But what does that have to do with being a mother? Well, it's the essence of what we're called to birth. Married or single. This is, the singles are not left out of this. There are mothers who have not been mothers. They've birthed children out of their womb, but they haven't been mothers. And then there are those who've never had a child who have mothered many. Isaiah 54:1 tells us, sing and shout, even though you've never had children, the Lord has promised that you will have more children than someone married for a long time. And I'm a witness to that. I will be 63 this year. I have never been married. I've never had children, but I have so many children. I even have four living in my house right now. Can't get rid of them. You see, God has a way of supplying our desires in different ways if we're open to the ways that he provides and brings children into our lives. There's another translation. The Message translation says it very profoundly. Sing, barren woman who has never had a baby. Fill the air with song. You who've never experienced childbirth, you're going to end up with far more children than all those childbearing women. God says so. Isn't that amazing? He says, clear lots of ground for your tents. Make your tents large, spread out, think big. Use plenty of rope, drive the tent pegs deep. You're going to need lots of elbow room for your growing family. That is such an amazing promise, okay? I mean, drive your tent pegs. I believe that that is, you know, the tent was the covering. And he's saying, make sure that everything that you're going to cover these children with is secure. Make sure that you're deep in the spirit. You know, when they're building a building, depending on the height of the building, is how deep they dig beneath it to make the foundation sure to be able to carry the weight on top. So he's saying, drive your tent pegs deep. Make sure that they are secure so that you can enlarge and go up stories and stories and stories to welcome all the children that God wants to bring into your life. And he goes on to say, you're going to take over whole nations. Pat, I believe you're in on this. You're going to resettle abandoned cities. And he says, don't be afraid. You're not going to be embarrassed. Don't hold back. You're not going to come up short. You'll forget all the humiliations of your youth and the indignities of being a widow. They'll fade from your memory because the Maker, your Lord, is your bridegroom. He's the one that's going to birth these children through you. And he is the Lord. He is the Redeemer. You who were like an abandoned wife, devastated with grief, the Lord is welcoming you back like a woman married young and then left, your God says. What a promise from the Word of God. Knowing God intimately leads us to giving birth. That's the key to giving birth. It says that when Adam knew Eve, she conceived. When we know God, we conceive. We conceive of the fruit of the Spirit, and we bear the attributes of Christ to the world. That is fruit that we can all live by. It says the fruit of the Spirit is love. It is peace. It is joy. It's long-suffering. It's gentleness. It's goodness. It's faith. It's meekness. It's temperance. There's no law against having this kind of fruit in your life. The Passion Translation says, but the fruit produced by the Holy Spirit within you is divine love in all its varied expressions. Joy that overflows. Are you ready for some joy, like some joy that you can't contain? That joy that is the strength that you need to get through. You know, joy gives you strength. It pumps your adrenaline and it just cancels out fear and anxiety in your spirit. And God is saying that the fruit of the Spirit, when we're intimately aligned with God and in love with Him, brings a joy beyond our understanding that overflows. It gives us a peace that subdues, a peace that subdues the lies of the enemy, a peace that subdues the attacks against our esteem, against our dreams, against our hopes, against our desires being deflated because the enemy's voices are coming at us. It says that peace subdues those voices. And then it gives us a patience that endures is a fruit. You'll be able to stand strong and firm no matter how long you have to wait for God to manifest something in your life. Just because you don't see any motion doesn't mean He's not moving. When you don't see His hand, trust His heart. And then He gives us kindness in action. That's charitable acts. That's when you don't have a child, reaching out to a little child that looks like it needs love, hugging someone, you know, adopting someone, fostering children, taking them into your home, ministering to them, mentoring them, speaking into their lives. Now, I'm famous for this, Pat. I'll be walking down the street and somebody will be pushing their baby in a carriage and it'll be raining and they forgot to cover the baby. Will I not stop that person and say, cover that child, please? I love children and I don't care who they belong to. I will interrupt and say, hey, did you overlook this child? These are things that God uses us to do. The spirit of virtue, faith that prevails. You see, we've got to prevail in some instances. It says that the gates of hell will not prevail against the church because we have a prevailing faith that makes us stand firm so that hell has to back off. In the face of our faith, it cannot progress. We shut it down. Amen. We arrest the works of the enemy as we stand firm in what we know about God. You shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Well, who is the truth? Jesus is the truth. He is the living word of God. And when we know him and we know what he says, we stand firm with prevailing faith. Then we have gentleness of heart. We don't have to be mean. We don't have to push our way around because we know who we are. We know whose we are, and we know what we believe. And that is the thing that cements us in a place where we're able to be kind, even in the face of those who are not kind, in the face of those who are not lovable. It gives us the power to forgive even the unforgivable, even as God forgave us, because we have strength of spirit. Strength of spirit. That's a fruit of the spirit called discipline. It's where we master our emotions. We master our mindset. See, that's the stronghold in our mind. Our mind is the stronghold. If we could crawl out of that cave in our mind that speaks doubt, despair, unforgiveness, bitterness, fear, and all of those things, oh, the freedom and the liberation we would experience. And so as we exercise discipline, we're able to come out of that place. Remember when Cain was upset with Abel and because God had accepted his offering, God spoke to him and said, why are you so upset? If you'll change your attitude or master your attitude, I'll bless you too. Sin sits at the door and it desires to have you, but you must master it. Master it. You see, in that giving us everything pertaining to life and godliness, he's given us the power to master our emotions. We can have emotions, but the emotions should not have us. All of this fruit of the Spirit is the very character of God. It is how we reflect him in the earth realm. Again, the garden mandate has not changed. He wants us to look like him, look like our Abba Father God in heaven. So mothers have been given the power to not only birth, but raise nations, to nurture children to grow up as the fruit of the Spirit. And through our nurturing, through the dispensing of wisdom and direction, we literally groom the character of those assigned to us, whether biologically or spiritually. This is the role of women ordained by God. Perhaps this is why God called wisdom a woman. Ha! Glory! I could shout right there, right? God called wisdom a woman and said that she was there before the beginning, assisting God in the creation of all things. Proverbs 3:19 says, the Lord by wisdom has founded the earth. By understanding, he established the heavens. And then wisdom goes on to say in Proverbs 8:22, the Lord formed me from the beginning before he created anything else. I was appointed in ages past, at the very first before the earth began. I was born before the oceans were created. And when he marked off the earth's foundations, I was the architect at his side. So you see, even before the beginning of creation, it took our Abba Father God and a woman by the name of Wisdom to birth the universe and birth the world. Whoo! Glory to God and hallelujah. Amen. So even before this all began, woman was present in form as Wisdom. The spirit of motherhood was present at the creation. Now, God imparts that wisdom to us freely, still releasing that nurturing wisdom to guide us to the full knowledge of his will so that we grow in godly character and make the right choices for our lives in a manner that makes the Father look good, because he leads us in paths of righteousness for what? His name's sake. We are here as ambassadors sent from heaven to make heaven and the ruler of heaven look good so that others want to go there. That's really what it comes down to. Now, that is why the enemy attacks mothers so hard. You got to know this. You have to know, ladies, that you have an enemy. The enemy knows how powerful mothers are. And that's, we see him persecuting the woman who was to give birth to the man child after God and God delivered her and cast him down to earth. So this was a war in the heavenlies before time began. And then we see him attempting to destroy Eve in the garden, to sever her connection to God so that she would raise wayward children instead of godly seed. You see, the enemy is threatened by godly seed because he knows it is the seed of the woman that will crush his head and his authority. So he's still after the woman. All the way to the book of Revelations, it talks about the dragon being cast down to earth, persecuting the woman, and then being upset when the woman got saved. And then he goes after her. And it says that a flood comes out of the serpent's mouth after the woman, that he might cause her to be carried away by the flood. And then it says that the earth helped the woman, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed up the flood, which the dragon cast out of his mouth. That's in Revelations 12, 3 to 16. Now, why did I bring that up? Because I believe there is a flood coming against women today. The flood of the media, the flood of fear, the flood of despair, the flood of disappointment, the flood of abandonment. All of these are floods that the enemy sends against women to cast her down and reduce her power to raise godly seed. Now, just take that in for a minute. Because we are the seed of Abraham. We are the seed of Adam and Eve. And it says that we are here to establish the kingdom of God. We are the remnant. And the enemy is not letting up because he knows of the power we have as women. Woman, you might be wondering why you go through the things that you go through. Know that it is the enemy after you and your seed because he knows your power even if you don't see it yourself. Some of you might be wondering what you did wrong because your children seem so wayward. Continue to stand. Continue to stand. The enemy is after the seed because he's threatened by it. In prayer, you will prevail on behalf of your children, and you will see them return and become a righteous threat to the enemy. I'm going to remind you of what I said at the beginning. Sing, O barren woman. Sing, O woman who is bewildered over the direction of your seed. The Lord is at hand. I want to pray for you. I want to pray for those who have birthed children. I want to pray for the childless. I want to pray for those who have lost their children, either to illness or a mate has stolen them or a senseless death. I had a friend whose husband kidnapped her children and she didn't see them for years. And I prayed and prayed with that woman. And finally, she was reconciled with those children and he released them to come home to her. It's possible. Don't lose hope. God is on the throne and in his days, he has written them all in the book of life, and he knows the date and the time of your release. He knows the date and the time of your prayer being answered. He knows the date and the time of your children being delivered. Remember, it says to bring them up in the way that they should go, and when they are old, they will not depart. That means some people just got to go and try some stuff out. I know I did. I'm confessing first. I tried out some stuff, but I came back to the Lord. And when I came back to the Lord, I brought my whole family with me. I was the first to be saved. But I know that my grandmother in Ghana, West Africa, prayed for my salvation when she met me on my 21st birthday. I know where that prayer got rooted, and I know when it was prayed over me. I came back home and I had a boyfriend who got shot and killed shortly after that. And I started searching and trying to find out what happens when people die. And I came to the Lord at midnight in my room by myself. So I know that God can send the Spirit, his Spirit, anywhere to apprehend your child and bring them back to himself. Don't lose hope. So for those who have lost their children, either to illness or mate has stolen you or even to senseless death, we're going to pray. Those who've been abandoned by their children, those who have missing children, those who are believing for children, those who have adopted children, those who are fostering children, those who teach children, and single mothers, let's not forget them. Each of us have our own cross to bear, but God gives grace for the assignment. And so I just pray, Heavenly Father, right now that you would spread your mantle over those that I've mentioned, that you will spread your mantle over those that are reaching up their hands to the sky even right now saying, yes, Lord, here I am. I need you to intervene. I need you to intervene on behalf of my children. I need you to bring them back. Those that are missing, bring them back. Release your angels on assignment to apprehend wherever they are to bring them back. for those who've gone wayward in their minds, for those who've been lost to drugs, to those who've been lost to gangs, for those who've been lost to waywardness and rebellion. We call them back now in the name of Jesus. I pray for strength for the women who have birthed these children, strength for those who are still waiting for children, that the Spirit of God would rise up in them and give them that peace that beyond understanding. Give them that joy that's overwhelming when it looks like there's nothing to be joyful about, Lord. You are the one that can still give joy that overflows. You are the one that can still give peace that subdues. You are the one that can give us patience that endures until you complete what you've promised in your word. You are the one that can give us kindness and action as we wait on you. You are the one that can give us virtue, strength, and excellence. You are the one that can fill us with faith that prevails. Oh, Lord, as we embrace the grace that you've deposited in us, let it release whatever we need to stand in the hour. Lord God, I pray for discipline to master our thoughts, to cast down fear, to cast down despair, to cast down bitterness, to cast down feelings of betrayal and abandonment, to cast down dejection and apathy in the name of Jesus. Father, we know that you are the God that sits on high. And no matter what people are doing on the face of the earth, you are sovereign. You are Lord. At any moment, you can lift your hand and say, let there be, and there will be, based on your word, the power of your word. And as mothers, we employ that word. We employ the DNA of being grafted into the family of God right now, having the same creative energy to impart the word out into the atmosphere, to declare a thing, and it will be established because we are the righteous of God. We declare righteous children in our midst. We declare freedom from addiction. We declare that the missing are coming back home. We declare that the sick are rising up and being healed. We declare that the rebelliousness is being humbled right now in the name of Jesus. We declare that those who have been stolen will return, that their father's hearts will be convicted, and they will release them in the name of Jesus. I declare fruit over the womb of the barren womb right now in Jesus' name. I declare that it will be filled, that the Holy Spirit will brood over that barren womb right now and birth a child by the power of the living God. Oh, Lord. We give you praise. We give you praise. Yes. We give you praise. Yes. And Lord, I just want to lift up Aubrey's mother this morning, the mother of the one that was killed in Atlanta so senselessly. I cry out on her behalf for justice, oh God. I pray that justice will be done, even as she releases those who killed her son, Lord God, and she walks in a spirit of forgiveness and release the whole family, Lord. I pray that they would be released to forgive, that they would have the grace to release those people from their hearts and trust you for justice. And Lord God, sometimes it doesn't work out the way we think it should, but ultimately you're in control and everyone has their day of judgment before you. And so I pray, Lord God, that they would stand firm in the trust and belief that you are sovereign and that you care for them. Precious in your sight is the death of your saints, oh God. You don't miss anything. You see it all. And so we give you the praise and the honor and the glory. I pray for mothers everywhere this day, those who think it's a thankless job, that they would be comforted by your spirit, that your joy would be complete in them. In Jesus' name,
Jesus,
amen. Amen.